Lift up your head. You think I ought to obey the Lord? You see, we didn't come over here just to inspire you and get you to run, jump, shout. We came over here to help you. So turn in your Bibles to Matthew 24, Mark 13, and Luke 21. Now you can find, you got fingers, you can just kind of find all three of those places. Get a piece of paper, and we're just going to read all of them one by one. We'll start with Matthew 24. Well, I'm going to talk about what Jesus said. Anything Jesus said, Brother Diamond, Sister Diamond, it's bound to be good. Can you agree with that, folks?
Amen.
Oh, I tell you, I love Jesus. He is my chiefest joy. He is my gold. He is my silver. He is my precious stone. He is my portion in this life. He is all that I desire. And I'll tell you, when you have him, you have the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And my desire is to please him, because he's got all power in heaven and in earth. Thank God for the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, I'm going to read something that Jesus said. In Matthew chapter 24, it's talking about Jesus and his discourse in the end time. And Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came unto him for to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said unto them, See ye not all these things? See ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, and the disciples came to him privately, saying, Tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? And Jesus answered and said unto them, Take heed that no man deceive you. Now that's the scripture I want you to remember tonight. Take heed that no man deceive you. Now, you see, when Jesus is talking about the end time, all of these prophecies being fulfilled, we don't have time, things of Jesus, and get ourselves fixed right. A lot of people living in fear, just afraid they're going to this, that, and the other. You know, you need to get the Word of God down in you. But Jesus said, the main thing he said here is, take heed that no man deceive you. Now turn to Mark chapter 13. Same scriptures. And in verse 4 it says, Tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign when all these things shall be fulfilled? And Jesus answering them began to say, Take heed lest any man deceive you. Are you listening? If you are, say amen.
Amen.
Now these are the words of the Son of God, the supreme, divine head of the church, the head of every woman and the head of every man. All right, turn to Luke 21. In Luke 21, verse 7, and they asked him, saying, Master, what shall be, when shall these things be, and what sign shall there be when these things shall come to pass? And he said, Take heed that ye be not deceived. Now you see, sometimes something is just recorded once in the Bible, and if it's recorded once, that's enough to make it so. But here Jesus very distinctly, in every gospel that talks about the end time and all of the things preceding his coming, is very careful to inspire each apostle or disciple that writes about it to put that verse of scripture in there. Take heed that no man deceive you. You see, he's saying that when the end time comes, and friends, we're living in it. We're living in it. Everything is shaping up to where it can just wind up just so quickly. You see, God is going to begin. There's 70 weeks of Daniel. I've been teaching about that. 69 already occurred, you know, to the coming of the Messiah. And it's got to be another week when God deals nationally with Israel. Well, he couldn't deal nationally with Israel until Israel became a nation. 1948, she officially became a nation. 1967, Israel, of course, became a nation that took all of Jerusalem, and no longer, for the first time in 2,000 years, the Jews had Jerusalem back again. Well, we know that all these things are set. The monetary system is all set for the Antichrist. All of these things are ready. We know the world is trembling today. I don't have to stand here and preach about that. Anybody that reads the newspapers, Dr. Keller knows it's so. The stage is set for the coming of the Lord, for the coming of the Antichrist, for the great tribulation period, and all that's going to transpire in the book of Revelation. But I don't know about you, I'm not planning to tribulate, I'm planning to go up. Hallelujah. Some people just take delight in it, in just proving beyond a shadow of a doubt that we're going to have to go through the tribulation and tribulate. I'd just rather find something that tells me I'm going up and shout, praise God. I don't know about you, you can tribulate if you want to, I'm going to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Oh, there's going to be a door open in heaven, and I'm going up, 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 praise God. I'm not looking for the undertaker, I'm looking for the upper taker, and he can come at any moment. Praise God. There's not a thing in this world that can keep Jesus from coming tonight. Coming tonight. Somebody said, I'm afraid I'll be left. I'm afraid I'll be left. I'm not. I'm part of the body of Christ. It said he's coming for those who are in Christ. Didn't say he's coming for those who had the baptism in the Holy Ghost. Brother, you don't have to have the baptism in the Holy Ghost. You have to be in Christ. Can you say amen? Amen. Can you say it out loud? Amen. Oh, my, I'm glad Jesus is coming back again. All the signs are just pointing to all that's going to happen during the tribulation period. You see in the first part of the book of Revelation, the church is mentioned 16, 17, 18 times. But after it indicates the rapture in verse 1 of chapter 4, never again do you find the church mentioned. You find a lot of people down here got saved through somebody's preaching. But I'll tell you, the church is in heaven having a good time. Now I'll come down here and straighten you all out on that sometime. Praise God. I tell you, I'm thrilled that Jesus has not appointed us under wrath. Dear God in heaven, read the book of Revelation. It's the wrath of God upon this ungodly world. God has not appointed the precious bride of Christ to that. He's appointed us to be dressed up, shined up, sparkled up, and going out to meet the bridegroom. Hallelujah. Amen. Could I have seven amens?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Well, it's a dark hour in which we live. The Lord's come. Untold legions of demons have been turned loose upon our generation. You know it's so. I'll tell you it's so. I'll tell you there's never been a generation rocked like ours. Our world is in a mess. Every nation and the continents of the world are being shaken by the infernal regions of the dark powers of hell. I'll tell you it's not some political situation. It's demonic powers. Demonic powers jumping from Vietnam, into Africa, someplace else, and the world does not know what to do. But we know that it is the end time. It is the end time. No doubt the Antichrist is alive today. I wouldn't be surprised that the Antichrist is not alive in this hour in which we live, because Jesus is going to come soon. Then he's going to come out, you see, and manifest himself to the world. Well, I'm not here to talk to you about that. I'm here to tell you that Jesus said in these dark hours, when the devil sees that he has just a short time, when these demon powers have been unleashed, never has there been so much homosexuality, never has there been so much sex deviation, never has there been such immorality, never has there been so much open, blatant defiance of God than in our generation. Folks, it's so. Why, driving in Houston, I don't know how it is here. Why, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, you'd be put in jail for putting the bumper stickers on that they put on their cars today. But today, they don't care. They don't care. There's a rising, there's an unveiling of evil power such as never before. Thank God, the Bible says when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will raise up a standard against him. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad the breath of God is blowing across the world? Praise God. I tell you, God's not over in the corner saying I'm defeated. God's just blowing, Maren, blowing all the way across the world. And there's Holy Ghost revival. And I'll tell you, there's a band of people rising up in every state all over the world and saying, no, devil, you can't have my family. I'm standing in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, go ahead and clap. Yes, sirree. I like how he does. Hallelujah. When he gets happy, he shakes his head. Praise the Lord. Well, now Jesus said, take heed that no man deceive you. I'm talking to you. I'm talking to you up yonder in the loft, Murphy Ray. I'm talking to you. Listen to me. I'm going to ask you what I'm preaching about. I'm talking to you on the back row. See, you're not as close down here as the rest of them. I'm talking to you back here. The Bible says, Jesus said, beware lest any man deceive you. What he's saying, Donald, to me in these scriptures is this, that when all these things begin to come to pass, there's going to be an opportunity for a lot of people to be deceived. See, there'll be a spirit of deception throughout the world. Why, dear Lord in heaven, over here in New Orleans, they don't do this out in our airport, but in New Orleans, all those poor young people turned loose over there in that Hare Krishna, whatever it is, that they got going, you know, and they're selling those books. Have you ever been over there? Why, I said to them, one of them said, how are you? I said, I'm saved, filled with the Holy Ghost, baptized in the Holy Ghost, washed in the blood on my way to heaven. He said, do you sin? I said, do you? He said, no. I said, if I do, the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses me from sin. And he said, do you eat hamburger? Do you eat steak? Do you eat cow? Do you eat pork? He said, if you do, you're a murderer. Dear God, I didn't shoot the pig. I just ate him. Hallelujah. Praise God. But can you imagine? Can you imagine? One of them got kind of mad at me. I got tickled at him, you know. But he got mad. He said, you're going to hell. But I thought, how deceived. They're deceived. They're somebody's sons. Somebody's daughters deceived into all that business. But every kind of deception in the world is going around today. All kind of deception. I mean, in so-called full gospel churches. So-called full gospel circles, I might say. It's enough to make the angels weep at some of the garbage and some of the trash that's being pushed upon God's people today. Deceived. Getting off in all sorts of ideas. Why, deception on morals. Did you know that people today will sit in some churches and plan to commit adultery while they're sitting there so-called full of the Holy Ghost? I hate to say that on this tape that I'm saying, but I know it's so. I had a couple talk to me one time, won't know if I'd marry them. They're going to change. They were members of our church. I want to make that clear, get that on the tape. Anybody listening, yeah, they're not in my church, nor this one. But I said they came to me and wanted to change husbands and wives, wanted to know if I'd marry them. Knew of a couple that went down, supposed to be full of the Holy Ghost, praying at an altar. One of them married, the other not married, and praying about whether or not God was leading them together or not, you see. Well, you don't have to pray about that. You don't have to pray about that. You don't have to pray about shooting your wife, committing adultery, stealing, robbing a bank. Anybody knows the will of God about that. But oh, the deception. And then on the other hand, there's the religious deception, coming in with all kind of false doctrines and false ideas and just things to disturb the body of Christ. I'll tell you, Jesus said, beware lest any man deceive you. And I'm going to talk to you about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 things that you ought to know from to keep from being deceived. There are five ways to keep from being deceived in this generation. Now, I'd rather come over here and help you than just get you running around and leave you without the truth. So I want to talk to you about five ways you can keep from being deceived. How many ways? Everybody tell me.
Five.
Tell me out loud.
Five.
Everybody in here say five.
Five.
Ways to keep
from being deceived.
I'll tell you, there are deceiving spirits today. This know that in the last days, the Bible talks, some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits. I tell you, devils, demon powers come up and deceive people in this hour quicker than ever before since I've been in the ministry. I had a fellow in our church. And he came up to me, hadn't been saved too long. Always, though, ever since he'd gotten saved, seemed like he was out in left field. You know, there's some people I talk to, just by talking to them, I can tell either they're already out in left field religiously or they're going to get that way. There's just something kind of a little unbalanced in them. They just never have gotten rooted down, you know, enough. And he hadn't been in the church too long, you know, and been saved too long until he came to me and said, "Well, I'm going to leave here." I said, "Where are you going?" He said, "I'm going to another church." He said, "You're too shallow for me. I'm too deep." He said, "I'm too deep in the Word." He said, "You're too elementary. Your teaching is too shallow for me." And he said, "I've got to get where I can get something more deep that God's given me." I'll tell you, beware of people that want to go deep. God never said go deep. He said go out. He said go out. I'll tell you, you can get so deep, the only difference in a groove in a grave is the depth. That's right. Are you listening to me? Oh, I tell you, that boy, I didn't want him to go. I went with one of our men to his door, and I remember I talked with him, and I pled with him. I said, "Don't do this." I said, "Don't get out of the church. Don't get out yonder in the miasma and the awful entanglements of all of what I know you're going to get entangled with." I said, "Don't." Oh, he said, I tell you, I've got revelations you couldn't even dream of. You know, and he got out, you know, he just got out in that deep stuff, you know. Just got out, just terrible, just went worse to worse. Well, to make a long story short, just tragedy after tragedy after tragedy. Finally, just a young man just died just the other day. Just now, not because he left our church, but he did die. And it was a pitiful case. I had a person come to me one time, and still in our church, I think, but we got him straightened out. And they said, "Brother Osteen, God's given me revelation that he said even you wouldn't believe." I said, "It's a lie." Just right in their face. Happened to be a woman. Just imagine going to your pastor saying, "God's given me revelation that even you wouldn't believe." I just believe in confront him. I said, "It's a lie." She said, "It is." Oh, I tell you, I believe in confronting things. I believe in just keeping a strong hand on the devil. And I said, "Let me tell you something. That's not God talking to you. I'm willing to believe anything that's right." Anytime you got, I'll tell you, beware of anything. I think you mentioned this a while ago, but I was going to say it anyway. Beware of anybody or anything that says something like this: "I have a revelation very few people are going to get in these last days." Getting kind of quiet in here. Beware of revelations that get people off in secret meetings that you are too unspiritual to attend. I want to tell you something, friends. Somebody wanted to come to our church. They wanted to come over there to visit and see a film, but they were not permitted to by their leader. I want to tell you tonight that Jesus died. There was a day in the Old Testament when the prophet, priest, and king were anointed by the Holy Ghost, and only the high priest could go into the Holy of Holies and approach God for all the people, and the common people could not do it. But when Jesus died, he shed his blood, and the veil of the temple was rent in twain, and he made it possible by his death, burial, and resurrection for every child of God to be a priest, to go to God for himself. And beware of anything that would ever deny you the privilege of going to God for yourself. All right, number one, if you do not want to be deceived, always remember this. You must be a man or a woman of the Word. Write that down. You say, well, I know that. Well, write it down anyway. Get your own Bible, write your name on it, get it written on there, write it on the inside in case you lose it, and your address. And then mark in it. See, I mark in my Bible. I mark everything's good, and everything's good, so I mark under everything. I sat down on the plane. Man pulled out his newspaper in the morning. You know, I pulled out my Bible early morning flight. I punched him. I said, you getting the bad news, I'm getting the good. But friends, I want to tell you, if you don't want to be deceived, you got to stay in the Word. You got to stay in the Word. Somebody said, I don't have time to go to church to hear the Word. Don't have time to read the Word of God. Don't have time to stay in the Word. Then you're too busy. Turn to 2 Timothy, if you will. 2 Timothy, chapter 3. This know also that in the last days, don't you believe we're living in the last days? In the last days, perilous times shall come. Men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, heady, high, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures, more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. Now, at the end of that chapter, he talks about the Bible. In verse 16, it says, all Scripture, he encouraged him to go to the Word of God, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is what? Tell me out loud.
Profitable.
Profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Now, let's pause there. I mean, look at me, would you? I used to have the idea that that was just for us preachers, that we might reprove people with the Bible and correct people with the Bible and straighten people out on their doctrine with the Bible. And in a sense, that's so. Anybody that teaches this is so. But I don't think that's what that particularly means right there. It means that if I personally stay in the Bible and read it every day, from Genesis to Revelation, at least one time a year, walk with God and get acquainted with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and Isaiah, Jeremiah, and Daniel, and Paul, and Peter, and know my God in the Bible, that I am going to be safe. When it comes to these things he's talking about, it'll keep me straight on doctrine. Somebody come along with some kind of flashy idea, and I'll tell you something, just set up on the inside of me and say, wait a minute, I know that doesn't line up with Scripture. That doesn't line up with Scripture. You see, if you don't know your Bible, you got to run to your preacher every time you turn around. Know the Bible for yourself. Why my wife and I get up every day. I mean, the first thing we do, our children gone off to school, get our Bibles. We got us an answering, a phone answering thing. It preaches you a little sermon, says call back. We'll call you later. We're going to study the Bible. We don't tell them on there, but
We preach a little bit and say we're letting this little machine take these calls. Well, you got to make time for the Word of God. Got to make time. Some businessmen I know get up early in order to read the Word of God and lift their hands and worship God. And I'll tell you, let God bless them. Many a time, just through the years, I've gotten up way before daylight and read my Bible and got out under the trees. And I'll tell you, it's just wonderful to think about the Word of God and talk to Jesus. I'll tell you, it is profitable, and it'll keep you straight on doctrine. And it's profitable for reproof. You know, when you do anything wrong, if you're reading the Bible, you don't have to come to church and let Brother Matheny straighten you out. The Bible will straighten you out. Amen. Reproof. You know, let me give you an illustration about that. I'm gonna confess something. One of my sins. Don't look so happy, Don. But one time, there was a fellow who came to our church. You know, all kind of people come to your church. And this fellow, he really did have a good testimony, but didn't have a good attitude. And he had been a drunkard, and he wanted to speak, you know. And I really had planned to let him speak. He had been an alcoholic and delivered and so forth, you know. And he was in need, and so we just right off the bat just gave him $50, you know, right out of the church in order to help him a little bit, because our heart goes out to people that are in need. And I said, you just hang around, come to a service or two, and we'll let you speak, you know, and give your testimony, at least part of it, you know. And so he came, and it just didn't work out that he was to speak that first time. And he came back the next service, and I think I wanted to preach then. And so anyway, I really had planned to have him speak. And so he came back the next Sunday morning, and the Spirit of God began to move and the flow and such that nobody looked like was going to get to speak, you know. And he saw right away he wasn't going to get to speak, and he got real mad. I mean, you could just tell he was mad. He just got up right out there sitting in the congregation and just huffed out, just as mad as an old wet hen. Now, doesn't that make you day? And I wondered what happened to him, you know. I felt sorry that he got mad, you know. I really planned to let him give his testimony and bless the church, but he just had a bad spirit. He just got up just angry and just marched out. Never heard from him anymore for about 6 weeks or 7 weeks, maybe 2 months, Mary. And then he called me. And he said, Brother Osteen, he said, I'm getting ready to leave town. Said, I'm in great need. And he said, I just wonder if you could help me. Well, you know, I'm just human, you know. And I thought about how he stomped out of the church. And I said, well, where have you been going to church? Where have you been ministering? He said, oh, I've been over here at so-and-so's church, and they let me preach a time or two. And you know, just human, I didn't want to be just real ugly. I said, well, now you've been preaching over there, and you've been going to church over there. Why don't you ask them for a little help? And what I was really saying, you old rascal, you marched out of my church mad, and I ain't going to help you. You know, as if I want to tell the truth, that's really what I really felt. I wouldn't admit that to myself, you know. But you know, you kind of, that's just, don't look so innocent. You know, when I confess, everybody looks so pious. But you know, and then I hung up. I mean, we said goodbye. I said, now you go to that pastor. And then, you see, I went out on the patio and got my Bible, and I wanted to meditate a little while, you know, on the scripture. And so I was sitting out there now with my Bible after telling this fellow that, you know, one of the brethren. And so I was sitting there, and, you know, I was just meditating on the Bible, just some general scripture that I had my Bible open. And, you know, somebody got to talking to me that I didn't realize who it was until I'd got myself in a noose, you know. I heard a voice say to me, you know, just kind of talking, said, he's pretty bad, didn't he? I said, oh, he is. I just said, he just marched out of our church and just got mad. He sure is. And something else said to me, said, he should never have done that. No, he shouldn't. Pretty bad. I said, he's bad. I said, I've never seen anybody. I didn't realize who I was talking to until it's over, you know. And I said, he just really had a bad spirit. And then I heard a sweet voice that was talking to me, said, reckon he's one of the least servants that the Lord ever had. I said, yeah, he's a then I realized it was the Lord communing with my spirit, and the scripture rose up in me, inasmuch as you do it unto one of the least of these, my brethren, you do it unto me. I jumped up and ran in there and got on the telephone. I said, Lord, forgive me. I understand what you're telling me. You see, the word of God reproved me and corrected me by my just sitting in the presence of the Lord. Why you come around here, a lot of these false doctrines floating around? If you got the word of God in you, it'll correct you. It's profitable for doctrine, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. If you're going to keep from being deceived, you got to stay in the Bible. Anybody that reads this Bible every day, why, you're doubly safe from the deceptive powers of the devil. I don't understand how in the world anybody could know the Bible and get into some of the things that are going around today. Praise God. I tell you, you got to stay in the Word. Now, get your own Bible. I'd get me one and I'd mark in it. I'd read it every day. Now, I like the 10 chapters. You know, if you're new in it, I'd read 10 chapters a day, 2 in the Old, 2 in the New, 5 Psalms, and 1 Proverbs. That'll take you through the Old Testament one time a year, the New Testament 4 times a year, the Psalms and Proverbs every month. That's pretty good. You see, if you'll read it that way and stay in the Word of God, mark it, then God will have something to work with. Oh, God help us, for people turn loose in this generation without any knowledge of the Word of God. They don't know an apostle from an epistle. They don't know anything. I'll tell you, they think Dan and Beersheba are man and wife, and some of you do too, by the way you look here tonight. But I'll tell you, we need to know the Word of God. Sing Amazing Grace, some people say, who's she? Get the Bible. No wonder you're deceived. Get the Word of God. Get the Word of God. Had a young man come up to me, a teenager, just about like, a little bit younger than Robert back yonder. And he said, in a church, I felt some strange things in there anyway, and I left early. But anyway, he came, I was holding a meeting there, and he came up to me and he said, I'm a prophet. I said, you're a what? He said, I'm a prophet. I tell you, he didn't look like he knew how to chop cotton. I mean, the starry-eyed, doubt if he even owned a Bible. I said, you're a prophet? He said, yeah, I'm a prophet. I said, how come you're a prophet? He said, they laid hands on me in the church, and they pronounced me by prophecy that I was a prophet. I said, dear God, no wonder I feel what I feel here. Let me tell you something, friends. Nobody's going to make you a prophet except God. Amen. You better beware. The Bible will tell you things like this. You stay in the Bible and you will stay safe. Number one, be a man or a woman of the Word. Second, be a part of a local church and be faithful to it. Now, isn't that inspiring? Doesn't that just make you want to jump up and run up and climb the walls and have a Jericho march? Doesn't that just make you say, my, you mean to tell me I drove 40 miles over here to hear you tell me that? Yeah, and I'm going to tell it to you again, and you're going to be glad. I'll tell you who's getting deceived. People who are floating around from place to place like religious tramps. Are you out there?
Amen.
I know I'm going to make some of you mad before I'm through tonight. I know that. Oh, I tell you, friends, this is an hour when you need a pastor.
Amen.
And you need a church. And you need a body. And you need a fellowship. And you need a sane, sound, sensible body that is willing to ask you and to guard you and your family in these dark days in which we live.
Amen.
And I'm going to say something. I tell you, brother, you're full of the Holy Ghost.
I wouldn't be, I'd be with holy people. That's what I'd do. I know you said, well, I'll tell you those people out there in my church, they need the Lord. As you go back, and we are denied as missionaries to go back at least once a week and evangelize in their churches. Tell them about the Holy Ghost. But you see, we need to have local fellowship. It's the floaters. A lot of people, they don't want to have anything to do, you know. They want to come over here when things are happening, and then they want to come over here when things are happening, and then they go over here when things are happening, but I said they don't want to stay there making anything happen. See, a lot of people want to go and watch the walls here go all day. You see, that's when all the shouts going on, that's when all the noise is going on, that's when all the glory is there, and the walls are falling down, and they didn't realize that somebody had to be faithful for 6 days when the buzzing is shouting to make the walls fall down. I'll tell you what builds a church. It's men and women who will come when there's no shouting, when there's not any running, no gerrymarches, just in there because God says not the assembling of yourselves together as the manner of some is, and so much more as you see they approach it. You need to belong to something, and you need to have a part of fellowship, and you need to have a pastor over you to look after you as one that must have given account for your spiritual welfare. I believe in local churches. I believe in local churches. I tell you, we just have the best local church. I wish all of you could come to Houston. Just be in our church. Be just like this for you. Praise God. I tell you, I thank God for churches like this. Just praise God. Places where you can understand the Word of God. Where you can love one another. Where somebody really cares. If you don't want to be deceived, you get in. You see, if you're floating out by yourself, nobody knows anything about the answer. I like staying in fellowship with ministers. We need each other to watch after. And I think if I could run my parents off on some tangent, I could get up here just on my own ass birthday. Wait a minute, my mother. What's in my ear? Is it so? It's you that need to do the same thing with me. You watch after one another. It needs our power because the fellowship is what God has ordained. And I said, let me get your to get you joined this year, but I'll say this is a good one. Oh, I tell you, it's just wonderful to have a place to know that the other several pastors in our places all over where you go. But it is done with the Lord. Help us, Lord. Be a part of what God is doing today. And God will bless you. And you will have a place of refuge for you and your children. And I have 640 men.
Amen.
Number three. Stay full of the Holy Ghost. Or you say that's so simple. Now I'll take a preach. The Bible says, be not removed from the simplicity which is in Christ. Now, I want you to turn to Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4. And Jesus, how many of you believe he's a good example? Say amen.
Amen.
And Jesus being full of the Holy Ghost. You see, it's not only, I'm not only saying get baptized in the Holy Ghost, but I said to keep from being deceived, stay full of the Holy Ghost. See, a lot of people get baptized in the Holy Ghost, but somehow they got a leakage problem. I mean, they don't stay always full.
This is the end of side one. Please turn your cassette over at this time.
If you know it's possible to have the baptism without staying completely full, whatever you have. But if you want the flower error today, there's a lot of things floating around. The devil would like to deceive everyone in the future. He'd like to sidetrack you. He'd like to be confused. There are people today, husbands, wives, just one of them, absolutely deceiving them, and they have one in a closet. Why, this girl, she got in touch with, was working for a man from India. and suddenly she just got a lustful spirit, and that lustful spirit got a hold of her, and they got involved with each other, and that beautiful marriage that they had was just headed for the rocks. Another boy talked to me, said, "Would you talk to my wife?" I said, "I will." I talked to her, and she was absolutely deceived beyond measure. She said, "I there's no use talking to me." She said, "I'm through with this marriage. I'm going to marry this man. I'm going to do this and that, and I'm talking about people that's supposed to be full of the Holy Ghost." Now she wasn't full. No, wasn't full at all. She just had been a tip, you know, and didn't have any up to date experience like that. But see, now here's what happened. I actually came out on kicks. It just looked like, because I just visited it. I said, "It looked like to me, a friend, that your wife just called." Well, he had another word, and he didn't believe that. He said, "No, I'm not going to let my wife." Thank God for people on their high face and say, "No, devil, you're not going to have my family." And he told me later what happened, and she did. He got a hold of her. It looked like a hopeless case. She was totally deceived. Totally deceived. He said, "I did not did, brother." See, he said, I went several nights with my wife. They were separated. He said, "I just went to spend a whole night with her." And he said, "I took the Bible, and I wouldn't let her go see." He said, I preach a lot, and I rebuke the devil a while, and I reason a while. And he said, it looked like it wasn't doing any good hour after hour, all night long. He said, I read the Bible to her, I preached the Bible to her, I told her what God said, I stood my ground. He's a businessman. And he said, I just went on, kept up, and kept up, and kept up, and after several hours, way before an hour, I tell you, she told me herself what happened. She said, suddenly, some kind of a dark shadow, just like a dark shadow in a cloud, just went over me, and I came to my senses. She said, "My God, what in the world is the matter with me? Why would I think of leaving my husband? What in the world would ever get a hold of me to death?" But you see, you got to stay full of the Holy Ghost. Full of the Holy Ghost. He can see through that. Now, you don't have to give in to the devil. You don't have to back up. I tell you, the devil's alive. He's defeated. And he's suffering. Can come against you in many forms, in many years. And I'm not even touching on tonight. But I'll tell you this, if you're full of the Holy Ghost, Jesus was full of the Holy Ghost. That Holy Ghost inside of you is just like a little monitor. You've been around false doctrine before. Right down to the inside. You've been around false doctrine. And I've been around doctrine like it turned four ways at once. I mean, you just say, I can feel the spirit. I can feel. I can just feel those things. He, the Holy Ghost, is so dummy. He knows what's going on in the world. Thank God for the Holy Ghost. You better praise God for the Holy Ghost. Thank God for the Holy Ghost every hour of the day and night. Thank God for the Holy Ghost. You want to stay out of deception today. Stay full of the Holy Ghost. And he'll tell you what's right. You may not be able to lay your finger on it. You know, some of it's so deceptive. You say, "I can't, I just don't know just exactly about it. It looks like a lot of good people are in it. Looks like a lot of people are swept into it. Looks like everybody's going that way. And yet some kind of a little check down in here tells you it's not so. You can obey what you feel on the inside of you." Are you all out there? I have learned that God knows more than I know. He always knows more than we know. It's better to listen to him. God's wise. He's all wise. You can trust him. I have learned that I can trust God. I mean, if I don't even know that, I can't give a reason for it. I can trust him. I remember when I was in the Philippines, evangelizing, going over there all the time. I couldn't wait to get back when I got home. I just go back and forth to the Philippines all the time. And I was sitting in a restaurant over there, and it's serious day. I've been warned to pastor another church as long as I live. I was an evangelist. I was a happy evangelist. I was going all over the world, a worldwide evangelist. Glory to God, and having a good time. And God told me, said, "I want you to go back home soon." And it almost is, I almost feel just something to be a pastor's heart. Come in, and instantly, God said to me, "Go home and pastor that 10-feet barn that you left several years ago, 6 years ago.
Now, that's not something for worldwide dimensions.
Yeah, I mean to tell you, some go home and take that feed store, that tin bar, and be starting to say it, and be in the field like that. And I thought maybe God didn't know what he was doing. But I'll tell you, God always knows best. I came home, I was restless at first, but I just said, you know, it's easy to go. I mean, it's not hard to go. These are the children, tell you that. I tell you, tell you how to have it, they say, ready. It's easy to go, but it's not easy to obey and stay sometimes. But not obey God and trust his wisdom. Oh, come on, let's praise him, Lord. I'm going to be hallelujah. Oh, my God, I'm not going to be a voice of my project. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.